And so it's hard to believe that here we are in 2022. And I still can't believe that we passed 1999. We were in a new millennium now. Now, as you may have heard from the scripture reading, there's been a little change in plan from what you have printed in your bulletin. Last night, as I was still preparing for the message, I really became convicted to do something different. And I'm trusting, I guess that remains to be seen, that the Lord is leading. Why don't you turn with me in your Bibles to the book of John. Today, for those who are visiting, we thought, what better time than the first day of a new year for us to rededicate ourselves through a communion service. If you're visiting today, we're just so thankful that you've joined us in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We practice open communion, and anyone who has accepted Christ, if you would like to participate with us, and you're welcome as a brother and a sister in Christ. But we're going to look in particular at something that we see happening in the Bible. If you turn to John chapter 13, John chapter 13, and I'm going to begin reading at the first verse here. It says, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already entered Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and that he was going to God, he rose from supper, and he laid aside his garments, and he took a towel, and he girded himself. And after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded." Now, in our culture today, this may seem like a strange thing. We don't typically see people during dinner go from one party to the next and say, "I'm going to wash your feet." But this was a pretty common custom back in Bible times. You know, typically, you can even read when you go into a restaurant. If you're in the restroom, it'll say that there's a health law that, you know, people need to wash their hands before they serve and handle food. And that's been the law for years. We're even more sensitive to that here on the cusp of this, well, not on the cusp anymore, but in the context of this pandemic, people are a little more sensitive to sanitation and those things. In Bible times, when you went to someone's house to eat, not only did they wash hands, and it talks about that in Mark chapter 7 and other places, but they washed feet. And the reason being a rather practical one, they did not have all the nicely paved sidewalks and highways that we have that were only used by bicycles and automobiles. They shared the roads with the beasts of burden. And they were walking down the same roads that were walked by the camels and the donkeys and the horses and the sheep and the goats. And I don't want to take a lot of time elaborating. If you grew up on a farm, you know what that means. You know, and some of these old westerns, you know, they had the little porch and then everything else was dirt, and it was part of the horse's territory. And the roads were not clean. So whenever you came to someone's house and you would eat, they would often wash your feet. And they wore sandals back then, so their feet were also dusty. And it was a common practice, and this goes all the way back. In fact, you can read in your Bibles, you can look back in the time when, if you've read the story about David and Abigail, it tells us there in 1 Samuel that she said, "Let me be willing to wash the feet." Here you go, 1 Samuel chapter 25. "When the servants of David have come to Abigail," and this is about 1,000 years before Christ, "at Carmel, they spoke, saying, 'David sent us to you to ask you to become his wife.' She arose and bowed her face to the earth and said, 'Here is your maidservant, a servant to wash the feet of the servants of my Lord.'" That was an expression of humility. So when Jesus took this position of washing the disciples' feet, he was trying to teach them a lesson, for one thing, of serving each other. Now, when they came in for the Passover meal, the disciples had made plans. They said, "Okay, we've reserved this upper room. This may have later been the same upper room where the Holy Spirit was poured out. We're not sure. But they reserved the upper room. They made sure they had all of the food and the utensils and the things for dinner. And they made sure that they had the towels and the basins for the servants to wash feet. But when Jesus had the Last Supper with his disciples, he said, I've longed to have this supper with you. And it was them alone. It was just the 13 of them. And so when they came in, all of a sudden they realized, oh yeah, where's the servant to wash feet? And there was no servant. There was just them and Jesus. And they probably looked from one person to the next, and they thought, well, maybe John, you ought to be doing this. You're the youngest. And John looked around like he didn't know what they were talking about. And someone else says, Thomas, how about you? And Andrew, would you do it? You know, you. And they're kind of all hinting that someone else should be doing this. And finally they said, we're not doing it. I'm expecting to have a high position in the kingdom. You remember the disciples were arguing among themselves which was the greatest. And James and John went to Jesus and said, when you enter into your kingdom, they thought Christ was going to literally sit on an earthly throne. Well, he will someday. But they were thinking about an earthly kingdom where, you know, they said, we want to sit on your right and we want to sit on your left. And the other disciples found out and they got mad because they wanted to think of it first. And they're all thinking about this earthly kingdom and their positions in the earthly kingdom. And everyone agreed that Judas would make a good treasurer. They didn't know him very well. So no one wanted to wash each other's feet because that would look like you were the servant instead of the promising leader. So when they finally sat down to the supper and that was left undone, they were kind of shocked when Jesus rose from the table and he went over and he put the towel around himself. And he kind of removed his outer garments, and then he grabbed the basin and he poured water in it. And they thought Jesus was going to walk over and hand the towel and basin to one of the disciples and say, here, this is your job. But instead, Jesus got down on his hands and knees, and he started to wash the disciples' feet. That's where we take up our story. So let's go back to the Gospel of John here, chapter 13. And it says, he rose from supper, verse 4, he laid aside his garments, he took a towel and he girded himself. And after that he poured water into a basin and he began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. And when he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? This is something that the servants would do. Jesus answered and said to him, what I'm doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. And Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. I think he was so embarrassed. He said, no, you shouldn't be doing that. It's like even John the Baptist, when Jesus came to John the Baptist and he said, baptize me, John the Baptist said, oh no, you should be baptizing me. And Jesus said, no, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becomes us to fulfill all righteousness. Peter doesn't understand. He said, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Upon hearing that, Peter, as he often did, went to the other extreme. And he said, Lord, not only my feet, but wash my hands and my head. And you know, there's something a little bit prophetic in that. We all kind of need our heads and our hands and our feet washed. In the Bible, the feet are symbolic of your direction. You can read here in Isaiah where he tells us, how beautiful, and this is Isaiah 52, verse 7, how beautiful upon the mountain are the feet of those who bring good news. Feet is, you know, what propels you. It's your principal mode of transportation. My feet are unusually large and flat, so that just means I've got a good understanding. You'll get it. Proverbs 6, 18, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil. Your feet don't run away without your body. They only do it once, if they ever do it. It's talking about feet. It's talking about your direction, your walk. You know, the Bible talks about even the Sabbath can be violated by the foot. Isaiah 58:13, if you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, talking about going your own way, and if you trample on something with your feet. You know, it's interesting that in some cultures, if all of a sudden a woman should find that the wall had fallen down and that she was not clothed, Some cultures, the woman would cover her face. They're very careful about veiling their face. And in some cultures, they veil their feet. They'd be very sensitive about someone seeing their feet. And in California, they wouldn't veil anything. But if you look in Isaiah chapter 6, what do the angels do? It says these angels are on the right and the left of the throne of God, and they got six wings. And with two wings they fly, with two wings they cover their face, and with two wings they cover their feet. See, in the Bible economy, the feet kind of had a holy connotation. It represented your direction, or it's something that was often treading on the ground, and so it was a symbol of the lowest part of your body. If you wanted to show that you are humbling yourself to a person, you would get down at their feet. The Bible says, heaven is God's throne, the earth is his what? Footstool. It's talking about the lowest position. And so when Jesus got down on his hands and his knees and washed the disciples' feet, they said, oh, this isn't right. I mean, he says that, you know, I've come as one that serves, but, I mean, that was something for the lowest servant to wash the dirty feet that walk those streets, and the gnarly feet of the fishermen. That was a situation of great humiliation. You know, they also had a ritual going back to the time of Moses that when they sacrificed the lamb, and they first consecrated the priest, Leviticus 14:14. The priest would take some of the blood and they'd put it on the tip of the right ear, meaning that God would cleanse their hearing. They'd put it on the thumb of the right hand. I'm holding my left hand here, thumb of the right hand. And right earlobe, right thumb, right big toe. Now, I don't know that all of you knew there was a sacrifice where blood was put on the right big toe of the priests. That represents right as a position of favor. It meant that you would listen to the right things. You would do the right things, your actions, your hand. You would walk the right walk. You'd go the right places. So this was talking about the consecration. Again, the foot. It's a place of humility. Even in the New Testament, you can read in 1 Timothy 5, verse 8, if anyone does not provide for his own, especially those of his own household, he's denied the faith and he's worse than an unbeliever. Then he specifies which widows should receive some specific care from the church. Do not let a widow under 60 years of age be taken into the number, and not unless she has been a wife of one man, well reported for good works, if she's brought up her children, if she has lodged strangers, has been hospitable, if she has washed the saints' feet. So even after the time of Christ, they saw foot washing as part of what the practice was. And so this was a sacred rite. And when Peter said, no, Lord, don't wash me. And he said, if I don't wash you, you have no part with me. By the way, that is still true today. That is not just symbolic. We just had a baptism, the symbol of a washing. And Jesus says, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Have you been washed? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb first by accepting Christ? You need to be born of the water and the Spirit. Have you made your decision to be baptized? And then for those who are Christians, as you walk in the world and you walk with the Lord, it's just the natural course of events that sometimes we get muddied by the world. You know, we're in the world. It's just a constant battle to be in the world but not of the world. Someone said that a Christian, you want to be in the world, but you don't want the world to be in you. A Christian is like a boat in the water. And by the way, a boat belongs in the water. I always think it's strange when you went through the desert of Palm Springs and you saw someone that had a boat in their front yard on a trailer in the desert. There's nowhere to put the boat. A boat belongs in the water, but you've got a real problem when the water gets in the boat. But if you know anything about sailing, a boat that is sailing in the water will eventually develop barnacles. And every now and then you got to scrape off the barnacles. And if you're a Christian living in the world, you may not need to run and get rebaptized whenever you made a mistake, but that's what the foot washing service is for. Now, if you're a visitor today, let me explain. Some churches practice the Lord's Supper and they simply do the bread and the grape juice. Some Christians practice what you would call a full communion, in that we do the bread and the grape juice, but we also participate in foot washing. Seventh-day Adventist Christians are one of those groups. I remember when I first joined the church, I used to go to church on Sunday with other believers, and when I heard that Seventh-day Adventists practice foot washing, I thought, that seems a little strange. And as I studied into it, the scripture that we read this morning, it could not be any more explicit or clear. Let's read it one more time. Sometimes we maybe miss it the first time. Go back to John chapter 13, and you can read here in verse 13, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and your teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet, for I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them." And so we, along with some Episcopals, Mennonites, Primitive Baptists, there's a number of Christian churches that still practice full communion. As time goes by, it seems like a lot of sacred rites are minimized. Some churches, instead of having bread and wine, they say, since it's a symbol, we're just going to get together and we're going to have Coca-Cola and pizza for communion. They say, since it's a symbol, I'm absolutely serious. There are churches that do that. And it loses its sacredness. Now there's some that might be thinking, Lord, you'll never wash my feet, and I don't want anybody washing my feet. My feet are kind of gnarly, and toenails are curled, and that'd be sort of humiliating. Exactly. It's an ordinance of humility. If you want, we can come up here and we'll compare feet. I've been looking at my feet in the last few years, and they're changing. It's kind of scary. My shoes don't fit the same way. But when Jesus says, I'm washing your feet, he's washing our walk. Have you strayed from the path at all since you were baptized? Would you like to renew your commitment? This is why we do the bread and the wine. We renew our commitment to, he said, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life. And that bread is the body of Christ. That grape juice is a symbol for the blood of Christ, the blood of the covenant that we're applying. The foot washing is like renewing of the baptism. And so we still practice those things. Peter said, Lord, wash me hands and head. And he said in verse 10, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you're clean, but not all of you. For he knew who it would be that should betray him. That's why he said, you're not all clean. So even though Jesus knew that Judas' heart was not right, Jesus was washing Judas' feet. And I'll submit to you that I believe that this was the final appeal for Judas. When Jesus got down on his hands and knees and he was washing Judas' feet, I think it nearly broke his heart. And Judas wanted to confess. He said, Lord, I've got to tell you what I was up to. I've made a contract to turn you in. I'm so sorry. Will you forgive me? Jesus would have forgiven him. He would have forgiven him if he had done that. But then the devil spoke on his other shoulder, as they say. And he said, if he was really the Messiah, would he be down on his hands and knees like that? He doesn't look like a king to me. And he grieved away. He pushed away the Holy Spirit. The Bible says Satan entered him. He went out, and it was night. It was night in the soul of Judas. But at the same time, the other disciples, when he washed their feet, they had been arguing among themselves which was the greatest, but something transformational happened when Jesus washed their feet. There's a beautiful quote from the book Desire of Ages I'd like to share with you. And this is page 646. With the spirit that they had when they first came to the dinner, not one of them was prepared for the communion with Christ. Until brought into a state of humility and love, they were not prepared to partake of the Paschal Supper or to share in the memorial service with which Christ was about to institute. Their hearts must be cleansed. Pride and self-seeking create dissension and hatred. But all this Jesus washed away in washing their feet. A change of feeling was brought about. Looking upon them, Jesus could say, "You are clean." Now there was union of heart, love for one another. They had become humble, teachable. Except Judas, each was ready to concede to another the highest place. now with subdued and grateful hearts they could receive Christ's words. Paul's very clear that when we partake in the communion service, it needs to be with the right heart. Friends, God is not impressed with our rituals. You can read in Isaiah where God says he hates the feasts, even the Sabbaths, if it's not done in the right spirit. God looks upon the heart. And if we're going through this ceremony, we want God to do something real in our hearts. Isn't that right? Amen. You don't want to say, well, you know, in the course of my life, I celebrated 52 communion services. There's no credit in that. What God wants is what's happening in your heart. Are you renewing the covenant? What better time than here on the threshold of a new year to begin with the Lord anew? I don't know about you, but I appreciate an opportunity for a new beginning. Amen? And I want the Lord to forgive my sins. And you know, one of the things that was happening is they were putting away their differences with each other. Jesus said, all men will know you're my disciples by your love for one another. Amen? When the disciples got together on the day of Pentecost and they could pray together and they were of one accord and one spirit, God poured out the Holy Spirit. They were in one place and of one accord, he poured out the Holy Spirit. I'd like to say publicly and absolutely sincerely, if I've said or done anything to offend you, now if you've been offended by the word of God, that's between you and Jesus. But if I as a person have done or said anything to offend you, I hope you'll forgive me. I hope that you will ask that of anybody here. I hope you'll feel and express that in your families if there's been contention, in your marriages if there's been contention. I hope you'll let it go. I hope you'll see Jesus on his hands and knees washing your feet and realize that what he's done for us, and you see him on the cross dying for your sin, what right do I have to hold a grudge with someone else? That you'll let it go. Let the bitterness go. If we could love each other and be of one accord, we then empty ourselves and God can pour out the Holy Spirit on us. That's what I want our experience to be today. Amen? Now again, if you're visiting, in a moment we're going to divide. I'll have prayer. We're going to divide and we're going to break off into groups and wash one another's feet. Let me tell you a little bit how that works. Some of you may be here alone. If you're a man and you're here alone, you just grab another man and just say, I'd be honored to serve with you. And then the men will be going into the smaller of the multipurpose sections. The couples, if their couples are washing each other's feet, they'll be going into the larger section. Women will be going into what we call our chapel. It's really good that we maintain a holy attitude. You don't want to be washing someone's feet and tell them about the new sale at Harbor Freight Tools. You know, just pray with them. Say, brother, I'd like to pray. It doesn't have to be a long prayer. And we'll supply the basins and the water and say, I'd like to pray for you. And pray for them. Some of you who can sing on key, you might lead the others in a song. We want to sing and invite the Spirit of God. Come away from this experience with our hearts prepared for then the communion service. We'll do what we do quickly. Then let's gather back in here. And we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper together. Amen? And so with that, I'd like to ask if could we kneel together and let's pray and just ask the Lord to bless and then we'll divide for the foot washing service. I also would like to say at this point, we'll be dismissing those who are joining us via satellite or internet. And God bless you and pray the Lord be with you in this new year.